It was a great embarrassment for Microsoft when hackers broke into email accounts of 40 million Hotmail users. But what was even more embarrassing was the discovery that Microsoft really hates security. That's what happened when security researchers started disassembling versions of Windows from 95 to 2000 to investigate Microsoft CryptoAPI for security flaws. Turns out this was very important because A, Windows was bathing in security holes, and B, it was the most popular operating system worldwide. A recipe for disaster. CryptoAPI is an interface built into Microsoft operating system that helps developers deploy encryption in their software running on Windows. It was a very useful tool because it would enable encryption for things like online credit card transactions or transmission of personal data. The only problem was that at this time, the US government under Clinton administration classified encryption as munition, casting a ban on all experts of strong encryption. Every piece of cryptographic software had to comply with the Department of Defense regulations. What was the reason behind this idea? To protect us from terrorism, of course. Even before 9/11, the Defense Department threw all its money on this talking point. The attacks were just a turning point for getting Congress to officially approve of their methods. Banning encryption would allow the intelligence agencies to spy on their targets in the process of making everyone's computers less secure. Naturally, the US government hated Windows CryptoAPI, so Microsoft had to implement solutions. In order to ship the same versions of Windows worldwide, anyone who wanted to build encryption software on Windows had to seek approval from Microsoft. They would be bounded to never export such software outside of US borders and abide by the US legislature. To enforce this mechanism, Microsoft would issue digital signatures that could only be verified by Microsoft's signing keys. This would grant developers permission to deploy their encryption modules. However, a British researcher discovered that to cryptographically sign Microsoft's CryptoAPI, there were two keys. This means that two separate entities could approve software running on Windows. One of those entities was Microsoft. The identity of the other one remained a mystery. But then, Microsoft shipped a Service Pack 5 for Windows NT 4. Somebody down the chain of command at Microsoft forgot to remove information revealing the true identity of both of the signing keys. Chief security scientist at Ontario-based Cryptonym Andrew Fernandes found the names of the two keys. One was simply called underscore key, and the other one was underscore NSA key. There's only one thing the NSA stands for in the cyber world. And this meant the community of cryptography experts and privacy advocates exploded in rage. They declared this key belongs to the NSA, and Fernandes himself said this second key would allow the agency to install crucial security components on computers without users' approval. That was it. Every copy of Windows 95, 98, NT4, and Windows 2000 had essentially built-in backdoor for the National Security Agency. Or did it? Microsoft immediately denied all accusations as just pure conspiracy theories with no grounds in facts. But who cares what Microsoft says? They are busted and they are trying to make us trust them rather than our own eyes. Well, Microsoft was not alone. Not all security researchers were on board with this theory. Many experts argued that it would be unlikely for this NSA key to be a backdoor for the intelligence agency. If the NSA wanted to compromise Windows, they could have just went to Microsoft directly and made them sign their spying tools for them. Or just give them the key. Or anything other than putting a copy of a key that's meant to be so secret that it has the name of the NSA imprinted on it and could be found by anyone debugging CryptoAPI. The most plausible explanation was that if the key was indeed for the NSA, it would only be there to help them secretly secure their own government computers running on Windows. But this was in time before the Patriot Act and when Snowden was still an edgy Republican.
Studies show that conservatives are more attractive.
I don't want to live in a world.
Most people believed NSA didn't spy on domestic communications of hundreds of millions of Americans. Boy, were they wrong. So what was Microsoft's explanation? Well, the first response was that the NSA key is just a backup and the name is just unfortunate. Yeah, right. You know, I was thinking about creating a second channel, but I was wondering what I should name it. But I got an idea now. The Hated One NSA. Totally not NSA. So that didn't work. So Microsoft officials said the name is there because the NSA is the technical review authority for the US export controls. And the key is just to make sure Windows products are compliant with the export laws. That's quite a leap from just being a backup, but okay. But critics doubted that the Export Administration regulations would specifically require a backup key. So Microsoft said the second key is used for signing software on computers operating outside of US borders. This would make sense, but there was no record of the second key being used to sign any cryptographic module. Microsoft never backed down from its position. The NSA key is not a backdoor because Microsoft doesn't build backdoors for the government. It would be against who they are, and you don't have to worry about it anymore because Microsoft changed the name of the NSA key to underscore key 2. If someone gets mad at a company for shipping a software update for a hardware issue, just remind them how Microsoft once fixed a security vulnerability by renaming a file. In April 28, 2000, Microsoft ended the discussion once and for all with a claim that the discussion is just spiraling into the realm of conspiracy theory and all further questions went unanswered. So who's right? Well, despite Microsoft's terrible PR job, we have no evidence of anything beyond the name of the key. We don't have a confirmation that the NSA key ever actually belonged to the NSA or was used by the NSA. The name of a key file doesn't suggest anything, and everything beyond it is just a speculation. The US government eventually lifted the restrictions on exports of encryption and open source cryptography, mostly due to the fact the government lost a major case against Daniel Bernstein from Berkeley, who argued restrictions on source code distribution are a violation of the First Amendment. This case cemented the precedent that software source code is speech. Ironically for Windows and the US government, the existence of the underscore NSA key rendered the export restrictions completely useless. Researchers discovered that while changing the main key results in making Windows unbootable, replacing the NSA key allows a user to install their own encryption software, bypassing all restrictions. After this, existence of a third key was discovered, but this didn't help clear the waters by a bit. Does this mean there are no backdoors in Windows? No. NSA leaks from Edward Snowden revealed that Microsoft is indeed closely cooperating with intelligence agencies. Microsoft helped the NSA circumvent its encryption and built in pre-encryption access to Outlook and Hotmail. They also gave NSA backdoor access to their cloud storage and enabled the agency to collect audio and video calls on Skype. Microsoft also closely cooperated with the FBI and CIA. When the leaks first came out, Microsoft, like everyone else in Silicon Valley, denied all knowledge of the NSA programs. But this time, they really had to, because Snowden leaks also revealed that there was a gag order that forced US companies to lie in public about their cooperation with spies. The moral of this story is that the confusion and uncertainty about government mass surveillance is mainly due to the fact that the NSA has a dual mission, cybersecurity and signals intelligence. That means the same government agency is tasked with protecting your data and stealing your data, for making you more secure and less secure at the same time. The best way to solve this schizophrenia would be to break up the NSA and have a separate agency tasked with securing online communications and a separate one for intercepting them. Both would have equal budgets. This would force spies to focus on their targets rather than indiscriminately collect information of everybody and violate their privacy and freedom in the process. At the same time, the agency tasked with cybersecurity could closely work on strengthening open source cryptography and securing it against attacks from powerful foreign adversaries and future quantum computing. So you can have privacy and security and liberty at the same time. All you need to do is to break up the spies.